Hi everyone! In this video, I'm going to be discussing litho and biostratigraphy as well as sedimentary structures. First, let's start with stratigraphy. So a formation is a body of rock that has enough distinctive characteristics so it can be mapped as a unit. And so formation is just something we use a lot in geology to say this strata is different than this strata and we're going to classify it as a formation. And it's really helpful because then we can name them and then we can talk about them with other people, write about them in papers, and people understand what we're talking about. So that's why we have formations. Lithology is another main term you're going to need to know for this episode because lithostratigraphy doesn't mean anything if you don't know what lith means. Basically, lithology just means rock type. When we're talking about stratigraphy, we typically say the lithology of this layer of the formation is different than the lithology of this layer of the formation. Another main term you need to know is contact, which is just the boundary between rock units. So for example, you can have contacts between different lithologies or basically different rock types. So you can have the contact that middle arrow is pointing to, like the conglomerate sandstone contact, or you can have more irregular contacts like the surface above the conglomerate marking the bottom of the limestone. And this surface is what we call an unconformity, and you should remember that from the relative dating episode. If you haven't seen that one, I talk about unconformities there. But basically, it's a contact that marks an erosional surface, meaning that there was rock there that's been eroded away, and so you have missing time there. And then the contact comes out all irregular, and so you can tell. This is really important in stratigraphy because if everything was just continuous without erosional boundaries, everything would be super easy to follow, but it's not. And it's because we have these erosional unconformities, and it's good that we can notice them because if we couldn't, we'd be wrong about a lot. The next term you need to know is stratigraphic section or strat sections or strat columns. People call them a lot of different things. I call them strat columns. They're basically what this thing to the right is. It is a bunch of rock layers drawn out one on top of the other, just as you see on any outcrop. And there are a lot of templates and specific ways out there to make strat columns, but we're not going to be really going over those today. We're just going to be discussing what they are so that you can follow along with the strat columns that I will show you today. The reason they are important for stratigraphy is so that we can map out different stratigraphic sections and correlate them, which is what litho and biostratigraphy are all about, is correlating different sections by either the use of biological contents like fossils or lithologies. And that brings us to correlation. Correlating of strat columns allows us to determine worldwide connections of ancient geologic features. First, we'll go over biostratigraphy. Biostratigraphy, like I said, is using fossils to correlate strat columns. We can use fossils to do this because organisms typically lived in specific time ranges, which have pretty much all been mapped out for us because really paleontologists have done a lot of work. That's not to say there isn't more to discover. There is always more to discover. It's basically just to say we have a lot in our fossil bank to use when we're doing biostrat. One of the main types of fossils that we want to see when we're trying to use biostratigraphy is something called an index fossil. Index fossils are fossils that are super helpful in biostratigraphy because they mark a specific time in Earth's history. They can do this because they must meet at least two criteria, these being they must have been geologically widespread and they must have had a relatively short time range. The short time range helps us because that means that when we go up to an outcrop and we see that we have this index fossil in this layer, that means we get a more precise age on it without having to do any chemical analyses. And the geologically widespread helps us because if they're everywhere, that can help us correlate rocks of a certain age throughout the world, which is immensely helpful in historical geology. So let's practice. Now you guys might not know all of the geographical distributions of the fossils in the figure on the right, but based on the time range alone, I want you guys to tell me what you think would make a good index fossil and what you think would not. First, there's this fossil called Orthida. Now pause the video and tell me if you think that it would make a good index fossil based on its time range. So the correct answer is no, but this depends sometimes on other factors. But if we're looking only at time range, yeah, this one has pretty long time range from the Cambrian to the Permian. However, if you're looking at strata that goes from the Permian to Triassic, maybe you can use the disappearance of this species to understand exactly where that boundary is. So there are uses for fossils that are not necessarily index fossils. Next, there's this cephalopod fossil. So pause the video and tell me whether you think it would make a good index fossil based on its time range. The correct answer is yes. It has a very short time range, which would make it very indicative of a certain age in the geologic record and therefore a very good index fossil. The next fossil we're going to look at are bryozoans. Bryozoans have lived a long time. They're still around and have been around since the Cambrian time, so 540 something million years. And you should tell me whether you think they make a good index fossil or not. The correct answer is no. Clearly their time range is huge, and even if their distribution is widespread, they don't mark any clear boundaries in time, and so they can't make a good index fossil. Next, we're going to look at belemnites up at the top. Pause the video and tell me whether you think belemnites would make a good index fossil based on their time range. The correct answer is yes, their time range is relatively short. You can see just the Cretaceous period, and so they would make a good index fossil for the Jurassic Cretaceous boundary and Cretaceous Paleogene boundary, especially if they weren't geologically widespread. So I hope that gives you some understanding of what index fossils do for us and biostratigraphy as a whole. The next thing we're going to be talking about are trace fossils. Trace fossils are also very important for biostratigraphy. Unlike body fossils, trace fossils are just fossils of traces the organism left behind rather than the organism itself, such as tracks, trails, burrows, borings, or coprolites. Coprolites are fossilized poo. When you have sediment that has been disturbed by these biological processes, this is called bioturbation. And so therefore, when rocks are preserved with this bioturbation or trace fossils in them, they are called bioturbated rocks. You can see that common trace fossils on the right are from resting traces, organism lying on sediment, local motion traces, organisms walking along, feeding in, grazing in, and burrowing in sediment, and dwelling traces in which organisms are burrowing and boring to dwell in sediment. All of these leave specific trace fossil signatures, which we can identify and understand something about the paleo environment based on what organisms made these traces. Next, we're going to talk about lithostratigraphy. Lithostratigraphy is exactly what it sounds like based on what we talked about in the first slide when we discussed what stratigraphy was. We talked about what lithology was, rock type. And so this is just stratigraphic mapping based on rock type. You can see here in this figure that you can correlate different rock types. And to do this, they drew these dashed lines to show you the correlation. So even though they don't have a continuous stratigraphic map for this entire area, they can correlate different stratigraphic sections taken from pieces of a certain area and then map them all back together, and it comes up with this whole picture of what rock was there. When we're using lithostratigraphy to correlate strat columns, though, we must remember to take into account layers that might thin out. For example, the sandstone layer in this figure around time 4 thinned out going from the left to right, and this is indicated by the little V they had to draw with their dashed line, and that is because it thinned out and is no longer there in the furthest to the right column, and so you have to indicate this or else you're going to misinterpret the correlation. We also need to take into account other indications of missing sediment, such as erosional surfaces, which are typically indicated by a squiggly line, such as the one at time 1. Now pause the video and tell me if you remember what we call erosional surfaces or erosional contacts. The correct answer is an unconformity. Unconformities, if you remember from the geologic time and relative dating video, can be either angular unconformities, nonconformities, or disconformities. And in this case, the erosional surface is at the base of a conglomerate or sedimentary rock unit and is at the top of an igneous rock unit. So pause the video and tell me what you think this unconformity is. Angular, nonconformity, or disconformity? The correct answer is nonconformity. Angular unconformities are when the layers underlying the unconformity are angular to the erosional surface. Disconformities are where you have an erosional surface between two sedimentary rock layers, and nonconformities separate two different rock types, such as metamorphic and sedimentary or igneous and sedimentary. Another thing you need to know when we're talking about stratigraphy is not only can we use it to correlate, but also we can use it to understand depositional environment. We'll be talking about depositional environment much more in later videos, but in this one, I just want to introduce one concept, and that is trying to recognize transgressive versus regressive sequences in strat columns. To do this, we need to know that these two terms apply to shorelines. So in a body of water, you have a specific order in which lithologies progress throughout the shoreline. For example, if you're on a beach It may be really sandy, but if you go further out into the water, it will eventually become more muddy. And then in the shallow marine shelf environment, you will have limestone forming. And so this is the sequence that we see at most shorelines. And we can see this in the rock record because these layers overlie each other rather than are laterally adjacent to each other. And the reason that they become on top of each other rather than adjacent to each other is just because depositional environments migrate. And you may not be able to see a shoreline migrating with your own eyes in your own lifetime, but all depositional environments do migrate. And this is also called Walther's Law. And we'll talk about this more in depositional environment videos. But for now, just know that it migrates. And so because of this, we can map out transgressive and regressive sequences. And to know how to identify these, first you need to know what transgression and regression is. Transgression is the landward movement of a shoreline, and regression is the basinward movement of a shoreline. For example, if sea level rises, shorelines will start to transgress, moving landward, and if sea level falls, shorelines will regress. This causes specific sequences to form in the rock record. If you imagine this shoreline regressing, you can probably imagine that the mud facies will end up overlying the limestone facies, and the sand facies will end up overlying the mud facies on top of that, and that will form a limestone, mudstone, sandstone sequence. And then this, we can go to an outcrop and find, and we can say, hey, look, there's a regressive sequence. We can do the same thing with transgressive sequences. Basically, if you imagine this shoreline to the left here moving landward, you probably imagine that the mud is going to cover the sand, and then the limestone will eventually cover the mudstone on top of that. And that way you will have sand, mud, and then limestone, and that will be what we identify as a transgressive sequence. But that's the basics over how you might identify transgressive and regressive sequences. And while we'll be talking about depositional environments more in later videos, I just thought that this would be good practice for you all for actually applying stratigraphy to something. Next, like I promised at the beginning of the video, we will discuss sedimentary structures today. I'm just going to be showing you images of them because I think that that is the best way to learn them. So first, we're going to talk about stratification or lamination. Then we'll talk about cross bedding. Instead of horizontal bedding, it'll be crossing each other in like a pattern, and I'll show you. And then ripple marks. Ripple marks are things like you see on a beach. If you're walking on the beach, that can be preserved in the rock record, which is pretty cool when you find it because it's beautiful. Then graded bedding, which is either coarse to fine grain or fine to coarse grain, and that's what we call graded. Mud cracks are exactly what they sound like. If you've ever been to Death Valley or seen pictures, you see cracks in the ground because the mud cracks. Lastly, we'll talk about trace fossils bioturbation. We already talked about this, but I will show you some pictures of actual rocks with trace fossils and bioturbation because they're super cool. Horizontal lamination, stratification, it's just horizontal layering or bedding. And the difference between lamination and stratification is just scale. Laminations are smaller, and then at some point, there's a specific definition of like how many centimeters you have to be before your stratification. But that's all you need to know is lamination, stratification are horizontal. They're pretty easily recognizable when you see them. Crossbedding is really awesome. As you can see here, it's got some beautiful structures here. And we'll talk about what depositional environments these things form in later videos, but basically things like desert dunes and everything, they form and then they can be preserved, and you might find these beautiful crossbeds in those. Ripple marks, there are asymmetrical ripple marks, interference ripple marks, which are like diamond shaped, and then over to the right, there are symmetrical ripple marks. All of these different ripple types form in different environments, and we will be getting to those in different videos. Here's graded bedding. Graded bedding is either normal grading or reverse grading. Normal grading is coarse grain to fine grain, and reverse grading is fine grain to coarse grain. Now, they're not always going to be this recognizable in the strata. Sometimes you really got to get your hand lens out, but it's important to know whether there's graded bedding to help you understand the depositional environment as well. Mud cracks, like I said, these are pretty easily recognizable. Most people have seen them in at least pictures in their lifetime. And when these are preserved in the rock record, we can tell a lot about the environment in which they formed. Lastly, like I promised, some beautiful pictures of traces and bioturbation in rocks. You can see this beautifully preserved footprint footprints from who knows what organism. I'm sure I could have found it, but I didn't. In the picture on the left, and then you can see in the picture on the right, some cool burrows and other bioturbation marks. And these are also really indicative of environment. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you learned something about stratigraphy, what strat columns were, what biostratigraphy was and how we can use it, what lithostratigraphy was and how we can use it, and something about what common sedimentary structures there are and what they look like. And I hope the sedimentary structures got you revved up to look at some depositional environment videos. Thanks again. Bye.